Well, since it's Memorial Day, we'll have a bit of a Memorial Day type sermon, I guess you would say. I hope you was here last year, because last year I gave you the complete history of Memorial Day. I told you what day it became known as the holiday in which we know, how it all came about. I hope you remember all that, because we ain't doing it again this year. So maybe you remember all that, but Memorial Day is kind of a day that is set aside that we remember our fallen heroes. It's a day that we give in remembrance to honor those who gave the ultimate sacrifice so we can have life as we know it, the freedom in which we have. I personally have never served, but I have worked with a lot of folks who have. And there's kind of one thing that they have in common is it's... especially the few of friends that actually seen a lot of combat in not necessarily the wars in Iraq, but even further back. The one thing they all had in common is that they all cared more about the guy that was next to them than they did theirself. I can relate to that as being a member of the SWAT team in Livingston during my tenure in law enforcement. There was the thing, you know, you line up outside the door before you go do whatever, and I hate many has to hear it, but me and the kids were never on my mind. Not once did they cross my mind and think, I hope I get to go home and see them. The only folks I thought about was the guy in front of me and his family, because they're the only ones that mattered. I had to have his back. As long as I had his back, he got to go home and see his family. And the same thing for the guy behind me. You never really thought specifically about yourself. Keep that in mind as we go through this here today, because what we're going to talk about is that true camaraderie, that true friendship, if you will. You know, I made mention Wednesday night that come Sunday, we're going to learn a little bit about friends and how it's not enough just to say hi, how are you? It's not enough to call you on the phone and say, hi, how are you? There's different things that we must do to be friends. To everybody here, if you have a friend, raise your hand. Some of you guys ain't very friendly. Some of you didn't even raise your hand. But I guarantee you have a friend one way or the other. Turn with me to Mark. It's where we shall begin today. Mark chapter 2. As we read a little bit through here, probably not going to preach exactly what you may have heard preached through this before, but there's just a little bit that we want to look at. Hopefully won't keep you too long today. But in Mark chapter 2, beginning of verse 1, it says, "And again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. And they come unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? And immediately then Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, and he said unto them, Why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise, and take up thy bed, and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise, and take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine own house. And immediately he rose, took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, We never saw it on this fashion. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to you again here today, Lord, again, we come to you with thankful hearts, Lord, just thankful that we live in a country, Father, that we're able to gather together to worship freely, Father. We're thankful for each and every person who gave their life, Lord, to allow us to have that freedom. Lord, we're just thankful for each and every person who's decided to come out and take part of your service here today. Lord, it's the first, official holiday to the summer, Lord. There's a lot of places that we could be, Father. There's a lot of cookouts that folks could be at and a lot of time on the lake, but Lord, we just ask you that you could bless each and every one in your house here today, Father, because they chose to get to come and learn of you and learn of your word, Father. We're just thankful for that, Father. We pray, Lord, that you could just look in upon every heart that is here, Father. Just see the hearts that are in need, Father. Know that those that may be broken, Father, we know you know how to mend them, Father. We know, Lord, if you look down and see the lost, Lord, we know that you can convict them, Father. We just pray, Lord, that you could send that drawing spirit upon them, Lord, and just convict that heart, Father, to draw them unto you. Father, I just pray, Lord, that you could be with me as I stand and preach your word. Father, I pray that every word here today that will be spoken be according to your will, Father, and according to your wish. Father, I just pray, Lord, if I begin to get in the way, Father, that you would just set me down and have your way in our service here today. Lord, we ask all these things in your Son Christ Jesus' name, and amen. And as we look at this right here, we're not necessarily going to look at the man. We're not going to look at the man who was sick with the palsy, but we're going to look at his four friends. We're going to look at the four friends that he had, the true friends that he had. Because as we look at this, we know that Jesus had entered into Capernaum. He was there. And there was, if you read the verse the last verses of the chapter before, we see that he had to go far away, kind of into desert places because the press of people were so great. Jesus couldn't move about freely because people was coming. And as we look at this right here, there was four friends. These were four true friends, because this man was sick of the palsy. No doubt he was bedridden. No doubt he couldn't move. No doubt he may not even have known who Jesus was. If he was kind of stuck in his little area, he couldn't get out and go. He couldn't go see these things. And unless people came into him and spoke to him, he would probably not have known these things. But there was four friends that he had. These were four true friends. These were friends that when they found out that Jesus was in the area, they went to him. They gathered around him. Maybe they thought amongst themselves, maybe it was pre-planned. Maybe it's something that they had thought about. Well, the next time Jesus comes to town, we're going to go get Billy Joe. We're going to go get, whomever it may be. We're going to go get him. And we're taking him to Jesus. He may not even want him to go. You ever really truly thought about the portion of this? Because we tend to overlook the most important aspect here. But Jesus did not. We'll get to that in a moment. But we tend to overlook this, and we just tend to see that there was a man who was sick, who was lame, and Jesus healed him, and there was a miracle, and that's what we perceive. But that's not exactly what we need to get out of this. We need to know that they were four friends. They were four true friends of this man. They were four people that loved this guy. There was four people that thought enough of him to take him to Jesus. Are you a friend today? Honestly, are you a true friend to anybody today? If you're not willing to do these things, I don't care a bit to tell you, you're not. Period. I don't care what you think of yourself, you're not a true friend. And straightway, many were gathered together. We see that there was a crowd. There was this huge crowd of people. There was a lot of people who came around. There was a bunch. Just imagine, if you will, that Oakdale was full. Just imagine, if you will, that we're all sitting scrounged up like this right here. There's people all around through here. They're sitting on the floor up here. They're sitting back in here. The doors are open. Every classroom's full. People's just stacked out there on the porch. You can't get in. There is no way that you can even get close enough to the porch to know what's going on. Imagine that there is so many people here because there are so many people with needs and they're bringing them to Jesus. Jesus is the same today as he was back then. He can do every bit of that. I don't know why we're so stubborn and ignorant that we won't bring it to him. But that's just the facts of the matter. That's what we are. We don't want Jesus' help until we really, really need it. But insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. There was just packed in here, just stacked people like sardines, if you will. They're stacked around like firewood. They're just laying around everywhere. There's these four friends, and they have a desire to get their friend to Jesus. And they come unto him bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. He was carried by four people. These four people are important because these four people, no doubt, there's one at the foot, one at the head, one on the left, one on the right. That would kind of be representative to the north, south, east, and the west, would it not? Those four friends would be very much representative of our church today. Amen? All around us. Completely surrounding this one individual. There was people all the way around him. They had him surrounded with love, with care, and with compassion. But there was four people, four true friends, and they brought him. Now, this is us. All right, stay with me. I call up Matt. Matt, we need to do something for Melvin. We need to help him out. I'm a little bit busy today, but I guess I can squeeze it in. You know, I'd say we can. All right. So I call Brother Lucas. Lucas, hey, me and Matt's going to try to do something really. We're going to try to help Melvin out because we know he needs it. I'm a little busy. It's awful hot outside. Well, I mean, what are we going to be doing anyways? Well, we're going to carry him. Oh, Lord. Well, I got an ingrown toenail. I don't think I can. Okay, I understand. You begin to call around. We finally find four people. Some of them's willing. Some of them's just there just because I promised to feed them afterwards. But then we carried him and it's hot. We walk up here. What do we do? Well, Melvin ain't that heavy. If he's carrying you, we might pass out. Well, we get up there and we see all these people. We can't even get to the door. We can't even get in there. Melvin, you know, buddy, we're sorry. You know, we're just trying to help you. We'll just take you back home. You know, maybe next time. We put forth the effort, and it's the thought that counts, amen. It's that thought that counts. We put forth the effort to try to bring you to Jesus and try to get you healed and all these things, but, you know, we just couldn't get in the door, so... Sorry, we'll take you back home. You know, we're sorry to get you out here in the heat and get you all sweaty and, you know, get your hopes up. Maybe you didn't even want to go. Maybe we had to fight you to even bring you. Who knows? Well, I don't know exactly how it went. But I know that there was four people who saw that crowd and didn't just slump their shoulders in their head and turn and walk away. There was four people that loved this guy. And there was four people, more importantly, that had faith. And when they could not come nigh him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. How many of you would be willing... Would be willing to stay with me. It's a pretty steep pitch on the roof right here, ain't it? Best I remember, that's about an 8. I put the metal on it. That's about an 8-12 pitch. It may not mean nothing to you, but it means that it's steep to me. But it means that me and Matt, we set up this ladder right here, and we begin to take it off the metal. And then we begin to, whatever tools that we had to try to peel the roof back, and we're just going to lower Melvin down in here. Is any of you willing to put forth that much work for your friend? Is any of you willing to tear a roof off of a place to get your friend to Jesus? Or are you willing just to walk up and see the crowd and say, maybe next time he'll be back? It ain't going to be the only time Jesus is going to be in this area. You know, he comes ever so often. We'll just wait till the next time. How many of us are true friends? How many of us are willing to do whatever it takes to get our friends to Jesus? You know, this guy was needing healed. There's a lot of our friends that need spiritual healing. Amen. There's a lot of our friends that are lost. There's a lot of our friends that are on their way, traveling at a high rate of speed unto hell. Amen. What do you do when you see a crowd? Maybe next time. I mean, I don't want to have to deal with all that bunch of people. I mean, can you imagine trying to carry a man on a bed through a crowd? I ain't down for none of that. I'm sorry. I mean, I just don't really want to. It's going to be 90 degrees. It's hot and muggy outside today. Amen? You think I want to carry any of you guys through the streets? Let alone tear off a roof? Amen, I should. Each and every one of you sitting in a church house today should be willing to do just that. You should be willing to be a friend. You should be willing to go the extra mile for your... Anybody here got lost friends? Even tried to tear a roof off to get them to Jesus? Maybe it's time we start trying. And they come in him bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four, the four friends. And when they could not come nigh him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they tore the roof off the place in an area where they could lower him down. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. Now, you just imagine all these people. Can you imagine right in the middle of service right now, somebody just busting through the roof? We would think, how rude. Would we not? Can you believe them? Can you believe that this man is standing and trying to preach and all you're doing is tearing the roof off where you can get in? Hallelujah, that's what had to happen in a church house. People should be busting in the doors trying to get to Jesus. But the bad part is, church, where the people standing outside blocking them from getting in. Why are they here? Why'd they come? Why are you wasting your time carrying him? Because I'm just going to tell you, if I had the palsy and I'd been laid up my entire life, I probably wouldn't be that pleasant to be around. I'd probably be a little hateful. I'd probably want to know why me all the time. I'd want to know why I was in this shape. I wouldn't care that maybe this was happening so that God could be glorified through my infirmity. That's not what I would care about. I would want to know why this happened to me. I would be rather contrary, if you will. I would be hateful. They wouldn't, nobody want to be around me. And then during this sermon, this preaching, if you will, and somebody tore down the roof to let me down in there, all of you ask me, why is he here? And then them four people, they wouldn't be friends, they would be hated. Why? Why do you waste your time going out of your way to help that man? Why do you waste your time going out of your way to help these people who care nothing about you or what you're trying to do? Because I care about them. Because I know that when they die, there's two places they can go. There's not three, there's not four, there's not anywhere else but hell and heaven. I know that there's only two places that they can go. And I know that it is my job to do all that I can to lead them to Jesus. That's your job too, by the way. It is my job to be one of these friends. It is our job to be this kind of friend. It is our job to be willing to tear the roof down of whatever we have to tear it down to get our friends to Jesus. They let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. And when Jesus saw, I want you to pay attention. It don't say that Jesus saw a man being lowered down. It says Jesus saw their faith. It didn't say he saw their willingness to try. They knew. These four friends knew. Whether the guy that was sick of the palsy or not, whether he knew, these four friends knew that if they could just get him to Jesus, that he would be fine. Where you at, friends? Why are your friends still in need? You ain't tearing the roof off nothing, are you? You see the crowd and you turn and walk away. I had the opportunity just this past, was it this past Monday? I got to go speak to a friend of mine, somebody that I call a friend and never really thought that much about it. This scripture hit me hard over this week. But I had the opportunity to go speak to him. I had the opportunity to grant insights into God's word, to maybe open his mind, to expand his way of thinking, to try to pull him out of the pit that he was in. And when I walked away, for the first time in my young pastoral career, I felt as if I had done something. I felt that I had actually done what God may have wanted me to do. For the very first time, I walked away and my heart was swelled with joy, with the opportunity to sit and speak to somebody that is on just the edge of the cliff, if you will, and get to talk to them and pull them back. For the very first time, my heart was filled with joy, and I desired to do it again. It's amazing when you can sit down and you begin to talk to somebody and you can begin to find out where they're at, whether it be spiritually, whether it be emotionally, whether it just be in life whatsoever, but you find out where they're at and you begin to talk to them, and then you begin to talk to them about Jesus. And maybe at first they don't much want to hear it, but they keep asking. Well, preacher, what does it say about this? Well, I'm glad you asked. I mean, let me just flip through here and show you. And then from there, we can go here. And then with this, I mean, we went through tons of the Bible in a matter of 15 minutes based upon one question. Where you at, friends? And what do you do? Are we the friend that will just call you on the phone? Or, you know, I heard this happen to you. You know, I'm sorry, I hate it for you. If there's anything I can do, let me know. And if you're here Wednesday night, we know that after we say that, we go right back into our own life and don't really worry about it, nor do we care. Or maybe we do say it, but we just hope that they don't call. Why'd you tell them that you was going to help them this Saturday? You know we got this to do. Oh, yeah. I don't worry. They probably won't call, and if they do, I'll just make something up. Been there, done that. Guilty. I'm sure most of yens are too. I know I ain't the only sinner in the church house. Bible tells me that. I know I'm not alone. When Jesus saw their faith, do we have enough faith that Jesus can heal our friends? Or are we the friend who says, you know, there ain't nothing to help that guy. He is what he is. He's been that way his whole life. Ain't nothing going to change him. Ain't no use in trying. Where's your faith? Jesus changed you, didn't he? Did God not come in and set up a residence in your heart and change you? Who are you to say that it can't happen to them? Where's your faith? Jesus saw their faith. I'd love to have a friend like that. I have friends. At one point, I had a lot more friends than I do now. It's just kind of those things that, as it's just the ebb and flow of life. As you get older, your friends change. Very few times from childhood to all the way through adulthood is your childhood friend still your friend. Whether it's over something petty, whether it's over something stupid, whether it's just because somebody moved away or you just went in different directions, your friends change. Amen? It happens. Friends change. There's qualifications for different things in the Bible. Amen? What qualifies you as a friend? In Proverbs chapter 17, verse 17, a friend loveth at all times. We all have mountaintop friends. Amen. Some of us may just be mountaintop friends. As long as everything's going good in somebody else's life, we'll be their friend. But we don't want to be drugged down by their problems. We don't want to have to listen to everything that's went on with them. I don't like having to talk to them because I don't care about all their problems and everything that's happened to them the last 15 years. I don't care. I don't want to talk to them. Some of us are that way, but we are to love them. A friend loveth at all times, no matter what you're going through, whether you're on the highest peak of the mountain or in the lowest point of the valley. It don't matter what is happening in someone else's life. It is our job to be there. It is our job to be their friend, to have faith in Jesus. That is our main goal. If you turn with me a page, it says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. You can't expect to have a lot of friends if you're a jerk. Amen? I mean, that's just kind of one of those things. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. You must be a friend to have a friend. Amen. And I know people that you just can't be their friend. I've tried. There's people that just don't want you as a friend. There's people that don't want you help. But lo and behold, I got to go give help. Someone who didn't want it. I got to go be a friend at a point in time when that's what they truly needed, but not what they really wanted. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Turn to Job with me. We'll come back to that in a moment. Fold it up and put it in your pocket. In Job chapter 6, verse 14, to him that is afflicted, pity should be showed from his friend. Some of us are very non-compassionate like myself. I have a hard time feeling sorry for people, especially whenever they do most of the stuff to themselves. I'm not alone. I'm not the only one riding in that boat. But rather than getting sick of it, I've told you, this is the 30th time I've had to sit down and talk to you and tell you not to do that, not to do what you've been doing, not to keep going down this same path, and here we are again. You know, I'm tired of it. You've made your bed, now lay in it. And then pick that bed up and carry them to Jesus, amen? Is that not what these four friends did? But this is what we say, you've made your bed, now lay in it. But are you willing to carry that bed and that individual unto Christ? No. Most of the time we're not. We get tired of it. We get sick of it. We're tired of going the same, doing the same things and having to be the... I mean, sometimes, in all honesty, we just get tired of being a friend. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Now, I want you to look at the response here. What should the response be? Joy? Praising? A hallelujah, good time just after that, right? But there was certain of the scribes sitting there reasoning in their hearts, why did this man thus speak blasphemies? They just seen a miracle, but they didn't like it. Now, friends, where do we sit on this end of the spectrum? When we see good things, when we see God begin to work in people that maybe we feel don't deserve it, they've wronged us for whatever reason, we're just not the friend that we need to be, we're not generally happy about it, are we? You're in church house, don't lie. Me and Vernon just talked about that earlier, about the lying preacher. Don't lie in church house. Don't act like you haven't seen some old drunk, some old drug addict, some old whatever it may be. Go to church and begin to get their life right and begin to see them prosper, and you're jealous. You're angry. You don't like it. You've went to church your whole life. You've been faithful and loyal to church your entire life, and yet here they come for 3 weeks and this has happened. We gripe, we grumble. At that point, who's the Christian? Friend. Friend, who's the Christian at that point? The person who is not promoting unity in the church, the one who is not promoting the edification of others, those that are not walking around with loving hearts and open arms. Friend, who's the Christian at that point? And again, to be Christian would be to be Christ-like. And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit, did you catch that? Flip back. Reasoning in their hearts. Didn't say they done it out loud. And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit, you notice that nobody spoke right there. Everybody catch that? Everybody back up and read it again. There was nobody that spoke. There is not one person that spoke. These people thought it, and there was reason in their hearts, why is this happening? And immediately, when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, why reason ye these things in your hearts? That's when something was spoken. So when you're sitting there and you're looking at your friend and you're jealous, you're envious, you're filled up with rage, with hate, whatever it may be, you ain't got to speak a word, and Jesus knows it, friend. So all of us that are said to be a friend, we must show himself friendly. All of us friendly folks here at Oakdale today, every time these emotions arise and these things come up, Jesus knows. You ain't got to speak. And Jesus just asked a question. Is it easier to say to this man, your sins be forgiven, or hey, buddy, just take up your bed and head right on out of here? Does it matter what God says? Does it matter how He says it? Does it matter as long as your friend, these people that have the faith to bring their friends to Jesus and God speaks to them? Does it matter exactly how He says it? Everybody should have been happy, right? I say unto thee, arise and take up thy bed and go thy way into thine house. And immediately he arose. But could he without the four friends? He never got there. Don't look at me and say, yeah, he could have. He'd have never got there if it hadn't been for his four friends. He would have never got to be in the presence of Jesus without his four friends. So friends, I'm asking you today, what are you doing for your friends? You come to church week in, week out. I've spoke to many people personally. They've talked to me about people that they know, situations that they're going through, whether it be that they're lost, whether they're going through a hard time, whatever it may be. My question to you is, friend, what are you doing about it? My question is merely this, friend, do you have enough faith to take that person to Jesus? Whether you have to pick them up and carry them over your shoulder and drag them unto Jesus, and when you get there, tear the roof off the place because you can't get in, and then lay them down and say, Jesus, we brought him to you. Are you willing to do that, friend? You know, you can learn about friends all the way through the Bible. If you flip over into Ruth, Ruth told Naomi, and I understand that Naomi was kind of going through a little bit of a hardship here. She lost her husband. She lost her two sons. All she had left was her daughter-in-laws, and she just told them to go back to your people, and I'm going back to mine. But Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee, for whither thou goest, I will go. You know, I understand what you're going through, but I ain't leaving you here by yourself. Well, preacher, I'm going to the bar to get drunk. Well, I'm going with you. I'll have a water, please. It don't matter where you go, I'm following you. And the whole time, I'm going to try to lead you to Jesus. Ruth, don't say that wherever you go, I'll follow after you. But for whither thou goest, I will go. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. And thy people shall be my people. And thy God, my God. Friends, that's what we should be. We should be willing to tag along, to stay with them. I'm glad MD spoke of fishing this morning. How many people, honestly, I need you to raise your hand in church house, they've been fishing? A lot of them have been fishing. When you go fishing, do you just go and sit on the bank like this? Stay with me. Is this how you fish? Maybe. But you got to have a pole in your hand, right? Or at least at your feet. You can't go fishing and just hold it, can you? I can't catch fish standing like this. I got to cast my line. Amen. But then if I cast it, and then just stand here like this, I still ain't going to catch nothing. I kind of need to have something on the other end of it, don't I? A few people sitting here saying, yeah, you can catch fish, then like, yeah, you probably don't catch nothing either. It's important to have a hook. It's important to bait your hook. If nothing else, you got to have a lure. You got to have a jig. You got to have something to throw out there. Amen? I like to bass fish. Me and a buddy of mine, we used to tournament fish every weekend. Had a ball, loved it. Loved it. My favorite thing to fish with, it was a frog tube. It's a little tube, looked just like a frog. You could take it and you could flip it up in the bushes at night. But I liked it because it was one of them finesse things. You had to work it just right. If you pick it up too fast, You ain't going to do no good. If you let it drop too slow, you ain't doing no good. You got to be just right. You watch that line, and you'll just see it thump like it's right here. And you can reel down, and you can jar down on him. You can set the hook and bring him in. The fight's on. Boy, we used to catch a bunch of smallmouth like that. Loved it. But I had to bait the hook, right? Now, Jesus said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Now, friends, can you fish like this? No. You can't walk up to them and say, Andy, how are you? I can't fish like that either. Just kind of stand here. If this bothers you, you can let me know. I ain't doing no good right here, am I? But if you bait the hook, you give them something. You got to throw something out there that the fish like. It depends on what time of year that you may be fishing is what you're fishing with. We go up in the Wolf River out in the fall and you'll be throwing a motor oil worm. That's what we throw and that's what we catch with. If it's any other color, no bites. You got to know what's going to catch the fish, amen? If I'm going to reach young Andy here and whatever it is he's going through, I got to know what to fish with. Hallelujah. And every piece of bait that I need, I can find right here. As I sat and talked to my friend the other night, we went from Revelation to Matthew. We went to Jude. We went to Titus. We went to Genesis. Then we went over to Deuteronomy. We went into Psalms. We went to Proverbs. We went all over this book right here, and there was bait everywhere. Everywhere I looked, there was something I could put on a hook and throw out. Hallelujah, I was fishing in the moment. I went, there was a man there that said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Church people, you can't fish without a pole in your hand and you can't fish without a hook. Jesus is the real. Amen. Just cast it out. But you can't fish, and you won't be a fisher of a man just sitting on the bank by the water. That ain't good enough. You can't just get, you know, close to the person in need and sit there. You got to be willing to pick up their bed and carry them. You got to give them something. Said there's a friend that'll stick closer than a brother, amen? Is that not what the Bible said? That's Jesus. That friend that will never leave you nor never forsake you, hallelujah, that is the friend that I'm proud to say I have. I have a lot of friends. I have people that I could call, no doubt, and would come help me no matter what was going on. But at some point, one of them is going to be busy. At some point, they can't. Sometimes they just can't get there. Maybe they don't know how to get there. Speaking of fishing, you ever got lost on the lake? At night? In the fog? Hit a log? Lower unit on your boat breaks and you're stuck? There ain't but just a few people you can call. MD tell you this. MD probably knows, but if he goes fishing down Dale Hollow very much, there's probably certain parts of the lake that he knows really well and there's other parts that he don't really know. Me and a buddy of mine, when he's fishing, it got foggy. It's late summer. The lake had just turned over and we hit a log. Lower unit, gone. Luckily, we had cell phone service. So we called. Hey, we're stuck. Can you come get us? Yeah, where you at? Lake. Well, no kidding. Well, we was coming from Holly Creek and we was going back towards Sunset. And it's so foggy, I really can't tell you where we're at. I know we're in the middle of the channel. And I know that I can see three street lights up on the hill. That's all we give them. That's it. It's only certain people that can get there, amen? They found us. We're the only dummies sitting in the middle of the lake flashing a light, but they found us. God knows where you're at. You ain't got to tell him. You ain't got to explain where you're at. You ain't got to go into this story of these three streetlights up on the hill. And I don't hear nothing around me. God knows where you're at. Let's stand together this evening. Matthew, if you'll come get a song.